spacious skies, o'er amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesty above the fruited plain.
Good morning, it's 9 o'clock. We will call to order the Douglas County Board of Commissioner meeting for Tuesday, June 14th. I'd like to note that there's a copy of the Open Meetings Act on the north wall of the legislative chambers, and also note that there's an automatic defibrillator available on the back wall of the legislative chambers, just in case. With that, we will stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
With that, we will go into the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Equalization meeting. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Boyle.
Here.
Commissioner Kavanaugh. Commissioner Duda.
Here.
Commissioner Kraft.
Here.
Commissioner Morgan.
Here.
Commissioner Rogers.
Here.
Commissioner Borgeson.
All right. Item A is approval of the minutes of the Board of Equalization meeting held Tuesday, June 7, 2016. Item B, call for a meeting and set Tuesday, June 21, 2016 as a date for hearing on certified assessment corrections and the addition of omitted property to the tax rolls or increased value of property. It's the will of the board.
Motion to assume A and B.
Second.
It's motion by Kraft, second by Duda. Please vote.
Every Commissioner Kraft, Boyle, and Kavanaugh.
Well, we need votes, gentlemen. Somebody, one person vote to
okay.
Can I vote for you?
Motion passes.
Okay. Item C, citizens' comments. This is an opportunity for citizens to speak on any agenda item that is not officially listed on the Board of Equalization's agenda. Are there any citizens' comments at this time? Are there any citizens' comments at this time? Seeing none, we'll move on to resolutions D and E. What's the will of the board?
Do we need executive session for anything?
I was not notified.
No need for executive session.
Okay.
Teresa here at County Attorney's Office. I'm not aware of an executive session that's needed for BOE.
And life is good. With the approval of the board, I would approve resolutions D, E, and adjournment as the Board of Equalization.
Motion by Duda, second by Kraft. Please vote.
Motion passes.
We will now go on to the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Corrections. Roll call.
Commissioner Boyle.
Here.
Commissioner Borgeson. Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Here.
Commissioner Duda.
Here.
Commissioner Kraft.
Here.
Commissioner Morgan.
Here.
Mr. Chair.
Here. Item 1, approval of the minutes for the Board of Corrections meeting held Tuesday, May 17th, 2006. It's the action of the board. It's motion by Boyle, second by Morgan. Please vote.
Motion passes.
Item 2, citizens' comments. Are there any citizens that would like to comment on any agenda item not officially listed on the Board of Corrections agenda? Again, are there any citizens that would like to comment on any item not officially listed on the Board of Corrections agenda? Seeing none, we'll go on to item 3, report from the Director of Corrections. Director Foxhall.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Yeah, before you, my main report for 2016 for Douglas County Department of Corrections. Closure number one, administrative services. I'm pleased to report that we remain under budget as we move into the final few days of the fiscal year. Closure number two, community corrections and in-house programs. Justine Wall and Mike Myers were able to participate in the first committee meeting to plan the Veterans Treatment Court launch in Douglas County. That committee is planning to launch the court in the fall of 2016. We will keep you apprised as to the progress. 24/7 alcohol sobriety program. There were 19 new admissions, 3,286 breath tests were administered, 13 positive for alcohol use, or 5 no-shows for testing. Overall, all compliance is calculated at approximately 99.5%. 33 individuals were monitored for 824 days of SCRAM testing. There were no reported no-shows, no two tampering violations, and no alcohol violations. Overall, SCRAM compliance was 99.8%. Work release unit admitted 32 individuals for the month of May. Those individuals donated 1,171 hours of community service to various public and private charities. House arrest admitted 63 individuals for the month of May, and those individuals contributed 244 hours of community service. Reentry Service Assistance Program, or RAP, 27 individuals were admitted to the program during the month. One individual was able to obtain their GED. Corrections programs, or in-house programs, 39 individuals were admitted for the month of May. Pretrial services, 23 individuals were referred for priority prosecution. 135 bed days were saved. 348 individuals were placed on pretrial. Last month, 809 individuals were managed on pretrial, and 302 inmates visited the law library during the month of May. I have no report for enclosure number 3, that's ACA, NCCHC, PREA compliance. Enclosure number 4, during this month, we had 6 individuals were promoted to the position of Correctional Officer 2, from Correctional Officer 1 to Correctional Officer 2. Officer William Kurtz received his 30-year service award. Sergeant Michael Piper received his 20-year service award. And I would ask that you take a look at enclosure number 4. Last month, we also handed out a number of commendations, in particular, several life-saving awards and several commendations and several unit commendations. And if you look at enclosure number 4, we list out under life-saving awards, Officer Laurie Barnhouse, Officer Ellen Condon, Officer Anthony Vecchio, Officer Michael Trapp, Sergeant Johnny Diasis, Officer Ronald Black, Officer Justin Colbeck. And as you can see, there are quite a number of other officers who received commendations. Just really kind of a highlight of the type of work that the men and women of the Douglas County Department of Corrections do on a day-to-day basis. The life-saving awards are really, I don't know how much more you can say other than these individuals save someone's life, literally save someone's life. And I think that's one of our highest awards that we offer. And very pleased that they are entered into the record today. And say my congratulations to all of the officers who were promoted, the officers who received life-saving awards, and the officers who received commendations and unit commendations. And again, just an example of the type of work that those men and women do every day in very difficult circumstances. Enclosure number 5, staff overages. Approximately the same, and when we have any staff overages, we use those individuals to do searches of housing units, searches of associated grounds, facilities, and the training, any type of training that we can deploy. Enclosure number 6, population, 1,440 intakes for the month of May. We had 1,394 releases for the month of May. Our ADP is creeping up. Was 1,138. We were 1,208 yesterday, so our population is much higher than it typically is during this time of the year. But we've been watching this population trend up. The female population again remains high. U.S. Marshal population was up. ICE population was down just a little bit. The felony pretrial population was up. The misdemeanor pretrial population was up. Although for the month of May, female population decreased a bit, but I did report we had some spikes in the female population. I think a record high was like 186 during at one time during May at four housing units open. So we continue to watch the female population, and it's on the increase again. Enclosure number 7, intake screenings, 1,278. Health and physicals, or H&Ps, 471. Discharge referrals for 579. Enclosure number 8, mental health, at 36 psychiatric assessments. Initial mental health assessments, 131. Mental health infirmary placements, 47. And if you look at referrals to community-based mental health services, outpatient site, med management, 11. Mental health and co-occurring disorder treatment programs, 247. Mental health therapy, 1,128. And long-term psych facility, 4, and that number is creeping up also. So you can take a look at the charts, and you begin to see our numbers creeping up, but I've been talking about that for quite a long time now. I would like to, that's a conclusion of a review of the summary of my report, but I'd also just say in light of recent events with the State Department of Corrections, we have taken this opportunity to review our operational procedures, and that's a very important review. We had a meeting with respect to that yesterday morning. We had a subsequent meeting to debrief the review at about 3 o'clock yesterday afternoon, and we have additional meetings scheduled this week. As it's a good opportunity to take a look at everything that we do with respect to ins, outs, receivables, deliverables, and operations, and we can discuss the outcome of that at a later time. And I think we've got a good review, a very thoughtful consideration given to the things that we do and how we move product, how we move people, and any changes that we need to make, and I feel that are necessary will be made, and I will provide you with a report at a later time.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. I'll try to be brief here, but I remember probably 10 years ago when after we're doing our culture studies and everything, trying to figure out how to run a jail better, how to improve things for everybody, and we did a wage and salary study, and we ended up, I mean, it showed that we had to give over $1 million in raises to our corrections officers in the new contract to keep them where they ought to be, and we did. And that was, I mean, it's always tough bumping your budget by $1 million of what you know is going to be there forever, always going to be there. I keep thinking of Governor Heineman, former Governor Heineman, pointing his finger in my chest saying, you need to learn to tighten your belt like the state does. That just so sticks in my craw. We try to treat our staff with the professionalism, I hope, that they deserve. The bar is high. We expect perfection. We don't want what the state tolerates. We don't tolerate that. But you do it. You're giving out 20, 30-year awards. You're giving out life-saving awards. You have a great, great staff, a great team in place. I'm so proud of the work that you do and we do, head and shoulders above what the state does. I mean, they have problems all over the place, and I don't mean to get off into other areas, but I just want to say how very, very proud I am of our entire staff. And it comes to the head. I mean, it's you, but it's not just you. I mean, it's been other great leaders as well. You've provided great leadership, but you got a good staff in place, and it is so important that we be as supportive as we can of everything that you people are doing. You're doing just a fabulous job, and I thank you for it.
That's why I highlight in our commendations and our life-saving awards the men and women that are on the front line. So much credit goes to them. As I said, they do a very difficult job.
Yes.
And they're proud of the work that they do. They take pride and ownership in what they do there, you know, 8, sometimes 16 hours a day. And I couldn't be more proud of the professionalism that they exhibit and the effort that they put in to what they do day in and day out. And the visitors that come in to the facility, or the audit teams that come in to inspect our facility, remark about the culture of the organization, and how nice the officers are, how professional the officers are, and these are audit teams that come have been all over the country.
Thanks.
You know, we have 3,400 jails in the country, so they speak well of our staff, and very proud of what they do. So that credit certainly has to be shared across all of the staff that we have at the Department of Corrections.
And that's where it's intended. Thank you.
Commissioner Kavanaugh.
I'd like to echo the sentiments that Commissioner Duda expressed relative to the excellent job that that you do in a difficult position, but one that's very necessary to the public safety of the community. The contrast between the tight ship that you've been able to run for us at the Douglas County Correctional Center and the continual problems experienced at the state level is stark, and I think it's a tribute to your administrative skills and the executive team that you have and all the people really who work at corrections day in and day out. I'm not aware, in light of the most recent escape from the federal correction or the state correction system, of a recent escape from Douglas County Corrections. Has there been one? I mean, my memory only goes back a little while.
What's the definition of recent?
I don't think that there has. But I think that the protocols that you have in place are, you know, good. And if you compare and contrast those with maybe some of the protocols that the state has employed, better, and they could probably learn a few things by examining your operation a little more closely. That said, I am interested in the mental health acuity pyramid that you give us monthly, which is very illustrative of the difficult tasks that you have in dealing with a population that, if I add these percentages together, appears to be about 100% or very close to it, a very high percentage of people suffering from pronounced mental health issues. Is that right? I mean, most inmates have some mental health issue?
About 60%.
Okay. And some of them are quite severe. At the top end, I think you've got almost 20% presenting with psychosis, including schizophrenia, schizoaffective issues, psychosis issues, for almost 20% of your population, which, you know, I'm sure is a challenge. And we have been, I think, trying to meet that. Commissioner Boyle's obviously been a leader in bringing mental health services to our correctional system, and I think that we've done a good job in a difficult area there. And moving forward, I think that there are some additional opportunities that may present themselves in the near future to enhance that capacity. But I just wanted to say I commend you and your skilled team of correctional workers on the job that you do, and on behalf of the community, thank you for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Commissioner Boyle.
I think Commissioner Duda hit the nail on the head. It's really leadership that you've provided and the staff you've assembled, the talent that makes your operation operate so well. We have the same truck coming to our facility to pick up our laundry. The same truck that picked up a couple of prisoners in Lincoln and took them out. So we have that operation here in Omaha, and he has made it secure. I mean, the difference could not be more stark. Ever vigilant, always doing spot checks, everything under the sun, making sure that weapons aren't in the units. It is a remarkable operation. Very talented people. You know, it's a kind of a corny phrase, but we do have your back, and it's because you've earned it, and so has your staff.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mark, let me ask you, your The numbers increase, so you're attributing, you have no residuals of Sarpy then anymore?
Yes, we do.
Okay, so a lot of that is mixed, the Sarpy and the female population?
A lot of our, well, more on the male side of the population. We're holding approximately 35 Sarpy individuals. So some of that increase is there, but the female rise has been trending now long before we began taking large number of individuals from Sarpy County, and as I spoke last month, tried to reach out to some of the providers in the community to figure out if they have some explanation for the spike in those numbers. A lot of what we're seeing, the assaults, fraud, drug use, which is pushing that female population up, and homelessness, we're still running pretty high in the homeless population in our facility, as evidenced by, if you take a look at the last chart on my summary, corrections homeless, and you can see that homeless population ticked up from April to May from approximately 163 per daily count to 186 per daily count. And at any one time, we could be well over a couple of hundred people who are at risk for homelessness, and a lot of females in that. But then also, you had a nexus to mental health acuity and homelessness and assaults and drug use, and it's trending up our numbers.
Okay.
Particularly on the female side.
Any other questions for Director Foxall? Seeing none, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Okay. Knowing of no need for executive session for the Board of Corrections, is there a motion to adjourn? Motion by Duda, second by Boyle. Please vote.
Passes.
We now call to order the Douglas County Board of Commissioners meeting. Roll call, please.
Excuse me. Commissioner Boyle, Commissioner Kavanaugh, Commissioner Duda,
here.
Commissioner Kraft, Commissioner Morgan, Commissioner Borgeson, Mr. Chair.
Here. Item 1, minutes and claims. Item A, approval of the minutes of the Board of Commissioners meeting held Tuesday, June 7th, 2016. Item B, approval of claims submitted for payment process through Tuesday, June 14th, 2016. What's the will of the board? Motion by Boyle, second by Morgan. Please vote. Motion by Boyle, second by Morgan.
Thank you. Commissioner Kavanaugh. Actually, did you want to abstain on this?
Oh, yes, sorry.
Okay. We'll note that in the record that you abstain. All right. Motion passes.
Item 2 is the consent agenda. There's 17 items. My understanding is there's an ask for Ian to be laid over a week. And with that, I'll ask for approval of the consent agenda with Ian being laid over a week. Okay. Commissioner Kavanaugh.
On the consent agenda, items M and N, I'd ask that they be laid over as well. I have attempted to discuss these items with Commissioner Borgeson, and we just haven't been able to hook up.
I'd like
to have the opportunity to talk to her before we pass on that.
I change that for not only N, but M. So I ask for approval with M and N be laid over a week. Oh, sorry. I didn't see it. Commissioner Boyle, sorry.
Yes. Well, I don't support the layover, and I don't want to cause any embarrassment for any applicants, but there was another, and that person's application is pretty thin. And if you look at the other person who was on the agenda, he has a long record of involvement with real estate, and it actually is especially at one of Omaha's largest and most prestigious firms, Baird Home. If you read his resume, which I hope you have, It is very long and deals with environmental law at the in various state bars in Omaha by Design, Jocelyn Castle, City of Omaha Administrative Board of Appeals, chairman at the present time, National Association of Commercial Property Owners Board of Directors. He's on that now. Just goes on and on. His specialty is real estate law, and we have an opportunity to appoint someone who's extremely qualified. And I think we ought to do it, particularly when we see, I understand fully why this resume was not forwarded. It isn't adequate, with all due respect. So I won't support the layover. I don't think we need to. I don't know what else we need to find out. If you read the resumes, it's obvious. So I won't be supporting it, and I hope you won't.
Teresa, you got a request?
With regard to Teresa York County Attorney's Office, the board may want to consider separating out A and B and taking them up individually, as I believe they are in opposition to each other. And the board, if they were to vote affirmatively on both, it might cause a problem.
Okay. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to vote on, we're going to remove A, B, N, and M and vote on those separately. So with that, I ask for approval of the consent agenda without A, B, M, and N.
If I made that motion, I withdraw it for approval. I don't know if I made that motion.
No, we don't have anything yet.
Okay. I will move to that effect, approving the consent agenda unless A, B,
M, and N,
and P has already been stricken.
Okay. And is there a second?
Second.
Motion by Duda, second by Kavanaugh. Please vote.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Point of privilege. I would like to see us consider these alone because I would like to vote on A and B.
We will.
And I don't want to vote in a group with M and N, throw them all together. I have different feelings about both of those. So can we possibly separate those?
We will. We'll do all of them separate. Those are out. We're going to do them separate next.
Okay, I thought you said part of the motion was to hold it over.
No, I proposed that, and as of discussion, that's changed. So okay. The motion right now is to approve everything except A, B, M, and N. And we're going to vote on those four separately.
Separately, okay, thank you.
Commissioner Boyle. Motion passes.
Okay. We'll now go to item A, resolution to deny demand for refund. Teresa, you want to explain which should go and which one should not?
Which one should we pick?
Teresa York County Attorney's Office. I think the letter
Teresa,
A.
Can I ask you to really speak up?
Yes, Commissioner, is that better?
Thank you very much.
Okay. Letter A is a resolution to deny a demand for refund. I believe a family by the name of Guard. I do not know if they are present. They may be to speak. And I believe Mike Goodwillie is also present from the assessor's office to address this for the board. They are asking for a refund related to property tax years, I believe 2009 through 2013, although they did not file a BOE protest or a TURC appeal for any of those years. And I believe the assessor's office has recommended to deny the demand, and the treasurer as well, to deny the demand for refund for those years. And then if you look at B, it's the family filing an opposition to that denial recommendation.
So,
So sorry, Commissioner, I did not hear you.
I'm sorry. How much does this amount to the refund?
I'll turn to Mr. Goodwillie to give you if he has a total for the summation of the years.
Mike Goodwillie, Douglas County Assessor, Register of Deeds Office. Happy Flag Day to all of you students of vexillology out there.
Vexillology?
Yes, that's the study of flags. I thought everybody knew that.
How can he be condescending if he doesn't throw something new in?
No. Just ballparking. I don't have the exact number, no. Commissioner Morgan, but ballparking it. The difference in value for each of those years is, I think, between $124,700 and $107,100. And so if you take the value numbers and multiply it basically by a rough 2% tax rate, you're looking at about $6,700.
Excuse me, does that go to every political subdivision or just us?
Oh, no, that's the total tax bill. So when you vote, you would be refunding your portion as well as, you know, the schools and the city and all the rest.
Approximately $1,300.
Is it, I think it's what, 12% or thereabouts?
12% of the 17 would be Douglas County.
No. Of the $6,700.
$6,700. And 12% of that is what the county's take is.
$760.
Is that about right? I understand some percentages. I know the schools are about 58% of your property tax dollar. I think the city's in the low 20s someplace.
Well, I don't mean to be rude, but I asked you this last week, and I was expecting to get an answer on this. I asked you how much it was, and never got.
I'm sorry, Commissioner, I don't recall.
So I would like an exact figure, because I think it makes a difference.
12% of $6,700 would be $804.
So it's $804 that goes to Douglas County over a period of 3 years. Is that it?
Actually, it's five. It's 9 through 13.
Five what?
5 years.
So it's 5 years, and it's $804 total.
To the county.
Okay, so how much do you think we have spent messing with this lady? Her house has been hit 3 times by cars, which is why she wants some relief. And we are messing around for $804 over a period of 5 years just so we can prove a point. I think this is abuse. I really am very angry about it. You inherited it, but I'm really angry. I don't think we should be doing this to taxpayers over $804 over a period of 5 years when her house has been hit 3 times by cars. I just think we've messed with her enough. I think we owe her an apology and a refund.
Are you through, Commissioner Moore?
I'm through for the moment.
Commissioner Kraft.
We have to refund the total amount. If we refund the total amount, do we get reimbursed back from the school districts? We do not.
That's a good one.
Okay. And I went out when this first came up and looked at it. Yes.
Actually, Commissioner, I think you may.
We may, okay.
Yeah, I think when you do refunds like that, then it comes back out of the different political subdivisions too in the end.
Okay.
I mean, you may front the money, but eventually you'll make a demand from those other subdivisions and they will pay their share.
And have we made that demand in the past?
You'd have to ask the treasurer's office. In the end, they're the ones that dole out the refunds.
Okay, yeah.
But I think that's how that's worked in the past.
When I went out there to look, I wondered, could the person build an earthen berm or something at minimal cost to prevent the cars from actually crashing into the house? I realize she fronts 120th Street, and people run the stop sign when they've had a little bit too much to drink just before they go into our 24/7 alcohol diversion program.
That's further on the way they're driving.
That's just a bad joke. Okay, but when you've gone out and looked at it, haven't you?
Our appraisal staff has, yeah.
And do they say, what does the appraisal staff say?
Well, they say that you could erect, I think the example I use is this, in my neighborhood, at the top of Cumming Street, you come down the hill, and then you go through the radial and then back up the hill to about 50th. And there's a house on the other side of 50th Street that had someone who got the brake pedal and the gas pedal confused and ran into the side of their front porch. And they've erected three or four small posts just shy of their house that would stop that from happening again. Our appraisal staff is of the belief that if the guards wish to, they could erect something similar just on the other side of the bushes that border their backyard and the sidewalk on the other side. And in fact, it was suggested to the guards, and they've decided that that's not something that they're interested in doing.
Is there in the audience a representative or a member of the family of the guards? Okay, I don't see one.
Whosever phone that was very snappy.
Okay. To me, it'd be a fairly easy remedy from what I saw, and it wouldn't be unattractive.
Well, you'd have to discuss that with the homeowner.
Yeah,
they've chosen not to do that.
Attractiveness is a matter of perspective. I realize that. And, I'm going to vote to deny, I believe, unless somebody comes up with other information.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. Let me start by making the motion to approve item A, the resolution to deny the demand for refund. It's not our job to figure out how homeowners should make their houses safer from passing cars. It's our job to say what a house is worth and to follow the process. We've got a good staff at the assessor's office that says this is what it's worth. I'm sorry that this house seems to get run into a lot, but it doesn't mean that the homeowner can say, well, pay me back the taxes I've paid over the last 7 years, and I'm not even going to submit the right paperwork for you. Just do it. That's not how the county functions. We can't function that way. We have to be orderly. We have to follow the laws. And it's not our job to make homes more protected from passing cars. We need to focus on what our job is and to do it properly.
I will second that motion.
Okay, there's a motion and a second to A. There's some more items, so if there's any more discussion on item, we'll continue. Commissioner Boyle.
Well, with all due respect, Commissioner Duda, I think it is our job to look at property. It's allowed in the code. When I've seen it many times, and I think Mr. Goodwillie testified to that last week, that valuations are reduced because the home is on very close to Dodge Street with loud noise and so forth. There is compensation made for a property that is not on a cul-de-sac and quiet and, you know, the birds singing and stuff. Homes that are in high traffic areas that have even been damaged by traffic, we are allowed as a Board of Equalization, and I think the assessor is, as the assessor, to assess the property and say, you know, this house, if this was at, you know, 54th and Dodge, about five blocks in, it'd be a wonderful home, but at 120th, it's tough. So I think we have the right to do it, and I think we do need to do it. So, and again, you know, there's no shame in settling something, particularly when we are spending so much money to recover $804. I mean, what has this cost in staff time for the assessor's office, registered deeds office, and the county board staff, the county clerk? I just think it's time to cut our losses, respect the taxpayer, and give them some relief. And I just don't see it any other way. I think that's what our job is to represent the taxpayer. Otherwise, what are we doing here as a Board of Equalization, to equalize property and also to consider appeals from taxpayers who, I think, in some cases have legitimate claims, and this is one of them. So I'll be voting to vote to deny the deny.
Commissioner Kraft.
Yes. One of the things that bothers me about this is that they did not protest their taxes during those 5 years. And, you know, they had the opportunity to protest. They may not have known their remedies, but they still had the opportunities. It wasn't until recently that they decided to protest retroactively. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. Commissioner Boyle and I started off on the same page this morning.
I'm sure, a little
surprised it lasted as long as it did. Absolutely, the process has to take into account all of these extenuating circumstances on evaluation, and that's what the assessor's office is supposed to do, and by and large, does. Obviously, we have the appeal process to this board, but for us to take one individual property and have one snippet of information provided to us about the history of this and say, okay, now give us money back going back 7 years, it doesn't work that way. If there are factors impacting the value of that property, they need to sit down with the assessor's office, discuss it, come to an agreement. If they can't, then they appeal to us. But you don't go back 7 years. And you gotta jump through the hoops properly. You gotta be following the process. For us to intervene on one property and say, okay, we'll let the system work for every other property in the county except this one property because somebody brought one factor to our attention, so we'll go back however many years they want and adjust whatever they want on it. That is not consistent. That is not how the process does work or should work. Thank you.
Okay, seeing no other comment, there's a motion and a second on, okay, Commissioner Boyle.
I wasn't going to do this, and the only reason I want to do this is that, first I want to say how much I enjoy serving with you, Commissioner Duda. It is a pleasure when we're on the same side, it's a pleasure when we're not. But I do think, and I'm not going to belabor this, and I don't want it to be back and forth, but I do have to take advantage of having the microphone to say something I haven't said to you for a long time. You're just wrong.
With that, we do have a motion, and a motion by Duda, second by Kraft on item A. Seeing no further discussion, everyone please vote.
We're voting no, right?
Motion passes.
Okay. Dang.
Teresa, is there a rationale to vote on B, or can you just?
Teresa, York County Attorney's Office. The B's rendered moot. You could vote on it, but if you did, you would need to deny it in order to be consistent. So the board's pleasure on that.
Okay, then we will skip that and then go now to item M, the approval of to reappoint Dr. Stephen Youngborough to the Veterans Service Committee. Is there a motion to approve? There's a motion, and there's a second. Motion by Boyle, second by Morgan. Commissioner Cavanaugh.
Thank you. Both M and N bring up the long-standing question relative to our appointment process or lack thereof. Nothing against either of these folks. I've looked at their resumes. They appear to be well qualified to serve in the positions that they're recommended. But frankly, there is no process for appointment, for term of service, for review, for discussion. These are all, it appears, ad hoc, one-off, no rules appointments. And they result in a couple of things that are not good or not best practices, as I've indicated before. One of them is the period of service can extend for, in some cases, over 30 years. Secondly, there does not appear to be any discussion relative to new applicants. In the case of one of these, multiple new applicants for a particular position. I'm not aware of another area of government or the private sector where that occurs. And I have attempted and hope to, by the time this comes up again, have direct discussion with Commissioner Borgerson relative to these and the overarching issue of our lack of appointment policy. And so simply to facilitate that discussion, and her schedule and my schedule, we're just unable to accommodate that discussion in the last week, despite repeated attempts, I'd ask that they be laid over, and when she comes back, we'll have that talk, and these will appear on the agenda in due course, I presume, next week. Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft.
Yes, and as a courtesy, I will support that. As you said, the appointments appear to be qualified, very well qualified. But I think, and there's no harm in laying this over, instead of risking denial by anybody, I think we should lay it over so we don't, so we can have an opportunity to discuss both amongst ourselves and with the chair the appointment process. You've said over and over again it should not be a rubber stamp. You've been consistent with that since day one. And I have to agree with you. You're right. We should not automatically rubber stamp. And as I understand, even though the resume may appear sparse, it from the second person, I would like to talk to both of them.
Commissioner Boyle.
I've asked our office manager, Karen Cole, to bring down the rules. There is a written set of rules about appointments, including, my recollection is, a 90-day notice to all of us that appointments are coming up, and so then we can suggest people. There are requirements of residency sometimes, and so those of us who live in the city don't have a lot of opportunity because it's usually required that they live in an unincorporated area. But I understand what you're saying, Commissioner Cavanaugh, but I think, and actually I'll tell you the truth, this is something that I raised hell about when I was first elected too. And that's probably why the rules were finally put into place, so to kind of shut me up, if you can believe that. But it said, thanks.
Didn't work.
But anyway, so there are some written rules that we can, you know, and I did visit with Commissioner Borgeson about these appointments, and I do think it makes a difference on that when you look at the resumes of the two people on the next item. I mean, there just isn't any comparison. So anyway, I don't know if Dr. Youngbird is in the audience. Is he in the audience? Sometimes they don't come. He's, may not have been available. So I don't know that that is really the essence of an appointment anyway. But I don't know what happens in the next week to make these suddenly okay that isn't already there now. The only thing I think would happen is that you'll talk to Commissioner Borgeson, and I was able to. So that's all I'll say about him. I have other things to say about him.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. It is my intent to support both of these nominations. However, it does not have to be today. As a courtesy to a fellow commissioner who asked for another week to look into this, I will go along with that courtesy. But I do think these are both good candidates. I don't think our system is that broken. However, I'm happy to allow you the opportunity for further discussion in the process. And therefore, is there actually a motion on the floor to lay
there's
over?
There's a motion on the floor to approve M.
And it's just M?
Just
is
M.
Is that the motion?
Correct. Just M.
All right. I would move to lay over M for 1 week.
Well, let's do this. If we're going to do this and there's a motion to lay over, I'm going to take the motion to lay over first. If the motion to lay over fails, then we will vote for that. Yep. Everybody clear on that? Okay. There's a motion. There was a motion by Duda, seconded by
Kraft.
Okay. The motion on the floor is to lay over M. Please vote.
Motion fails.
There is a motion. We still have Commissioner Cavanaugh to speak if he wants to speak on that motion.
Right. You know, I appreciate what has been said here relative to the process. I can only point out that the process is observed more in the breach than in the application. The 90-day notice, I have been here 2 years, never received one, not once. No discussion occurs except on the most ad hoc of bases among commissioners. In other governmental appointment scenarios, there is an appointment application. There is a hearing on all appointments at the state level. You will have a hearing before a legislative committee, which requires the presence of the prospective appointee for examination by that body. And a subsequent vote. I mean, we do none of those things. And we have a piece of paper that's supplied, sometimes not until the day of the hearing, in this case, for the duplicate applicant or the subsequent applicant for one of these positions. This is not a process. And if it is a process that is somehow on paper but not actually practice, that's not good either. So what I'm saying is that if we take a week to have this discussion, and we will continue to have this discussion every time this occurs, as long as I'm here, then there's no harm, no foul. These names will come back up. I agree with Commissioner Kraft. They both appear to be eminently qualified for those positions. But there is no process. And to say that there is a process because somewhere it says that there is, when it's ignored on a regular basis and not employed, doesn't make it so. And so I would ask that, you know, we take the time to initiate a direct discussion. I would hope that at some point in this discussion that's now occurred for over a year, we actually come up with a consensus on a process. That's my goal. I think there's a way forward on this. It will be better for Douglas County. It'll be better for the people. It'll be more transparent. And it's something that we should do. So I'd appreciate the ability to have that discussion with Commissioner Borgerson when she returns, and ask that we not approve these two today, but rather lay over. My understanding
One's already approved. There's one left.
I'm sorry?
One just got approved.
I thought we had a motion to lay over.
No,
we
the motion failed.
We did not
that motion failed.
The motion to lay over failed.
Okay. We voted on the motion.
No, but you already got the motion now, so your motion to lay over failed. The motion on the floor now is to approve.
Right.
But you got the courtesy to, because you're in debate now.
I understand. But the motion to lay over failed on a 3-3 vote.
Right.
And if the motion to approve is a 3-3 vote, the motion to approve fails as well.
No, true. I agree, but that's okay. What I'm saying. Your
so
vote is there.
So it hasn't been approved. We're going to have another vote. And I would urge you to, you know, vote the same way that you voted on the previous one, in which case the practical effect will be a layover. They will not be approved today. Correct?
Well, we'll soon find out.
We'll see.
When we vote.
I don't know where it's going to go. We'll see.
Yes, but if it's a 3-3 vote on the approval, what happens?
It's going to come back next week because Commissioner Borgerson will be here, and she didn't vote, and she'll bring it back, and it'll
Thank
come
you.
Back.
Right.
But with that said, before I give to you, Commissioner Boyle, in all fairness, there is notice given on all these appointments. I'm not going to say who reads what, but there's notice given. To imply that there's not notice given is unfair to the work of the staff on that. And there is a process. The process is exercised. To compare the process to the state is not fair because the state has their process. The city has their process. The city is an appointment by the mayor, confirmed by the council. The state is a hearing, confirmed by the Senate. Ours is, if it is disputed, which if we get to that point with Ann, I'll agree to the layover with Ann, even though I'm not going to vote for the person there, but there's two people. In my tenure being here, when there are two people up, the board in a public meeting votes for those people if that's the agreed. That's the process. That's our process. To say it's not a process is not accurate at all. So with that, Commissioner Boyle, you're in the queue.
There is a process. There's in our rules, it's Rule 13, notification of vacancies to boards and or committees, page 7 through, I think, 11, and then begins the actual process, 10. And it's quite extensive, and it does call for written memos to all commissioners at least 90 days before the vacancy occurs. Such notification shall be given by the secretary to the County Board of Commissioners, which is Karen Cole. And and then you go on to the purpose. It talks about, you know, and this came about a big discussion because of what happened. And let me mention to Commissioner Rogers my experience with appointments is that if you have two on the agenda, which I was the victim of being the second one, I had someone that I wanted to appoint to a board. And my nominee was placed second. And Claire is smiling because he knows what happened. The first one was considered and approved. So mine was, as we say in the legal practice, down the toilet. So mine was never considered. So putting two names on doesn't work, which is what this has evolved into, is that we reach a consensus, take a look at who they are, and you know, resumes and so forth. And then Commissioner Borgerson, as the chair or whoever the chair is, places it on the agenda. And then we aren't embarrassing other people with being voted down and so forth and never considered. And I think that's a serious thing to do because these are people who are members of the community who are volunteering their services. And I think their willingness to serve should be respected. But I don't want to go in and read all of these, but it's very clear, you know, what happens. And last yesterday, I opened up an email, and it had a highlight of the vacancies that occurred, and it was highlighted in yellow. And I think there's about six coming up. And so there is adequate warning. There are rules that are very clear, Mr. Kavanaugh. And we voted for them when this last January. We voted to approve these to reestablish them. And I assume you voted for them. But so there are rules. It's Karen works. I would suggest before you leave today, you talk to Karen, because she can fill you in on how all this works. But we shouldn't be messing with these people. Their names are on the agenda, and they have been vetted, and they should be approved. I don't think we need to do this to them.
Commissioner Kraft.
And reading under this, the selection process, this is on page 10, item D, all applications properly submitted to the county board shall be considered by the full board. And it uses the word all as one single agenda item, which lists the names, plural, of all applicants alphabetically. So who decided not to list the second applicant? We should have the courtesy of knowing. See, I did not know there was a second applicant. I did not see the resume. It doesn't matter whether it's sparse or very deep. It's still an issue of knowing who we're voting for. And you're right, the gentleman is highly qualified. And if you read his resume, it's, compared to the other one, hands down, that he's the preferred choice. But the other gentleman, this might be his first attempt to serve on one of these committees, and may not know how to, not embellish, let's see, fully fill out, and how to blow his own horn and say, hey, you know, look at all these things I've done. I would like to have on this next one, at least, a week's layover, since there were two applicants. I don't know if there were two applicants on the first one, or six applicants.
Commissioner Kraft, your point is valid on Ian. And that was, in my understanding, it was just a clear mistake. It was just a mistake, an honest mistake. Okay. That's my understanding. So that's why, when I brought up the point I made about after the process, mm-hmm. I'll vote for Ian, because the process has been, if there's two and you read the process. So that's fair. It's an honest mistake. That's fair. My understanding for him, though, there was no other point. And the rationale is, I mean, to get at the process, if people have been there for a while, they've been vetted. And that process, or that practice in some degree, is no different than, if you want to compare bodies, when the city council reappoints a person that's been there, the council doesn't give them a heated hearing to some degree. If they've been there, they've had their one vet, yeah. And they voted. So I just say that in respects to the process.
Right.
So your point is, yeah. Fair. That's fair. It's an honest mistake, and I think that should be considered on Ian.
Okay, and I will accept you. There were no other applicants on M?
On M, not that I know of. Ian, you got the one here. As far as I know on M, I don't know of any.
Okay, so I will vote to approve M, since there were no other applicants.
Did you say N?
M.
I think you need your hair aids in.
Commissioner Boyle, you had the... If you want to do that, that's a vote. If somebody wants to move that, that's a vote.
I'm not seconding anything.
Okay, I'm just saying.
I don't know. Do you want somebody want to second what he's brought up?
No.
Okay. Well, the comment that I have is that I was aware of and had read. I don't know why nobody else did, but I saw the other applicant and looked at it. And I guess, you know, in life there are times when, if you look at his application, with all due respect, this is getting awfully personal, which is one reason why.
You speaking of M or N?
I'm speaking of N, as in Nebraska.
Okay. Can you hold there then, Mr. Walker? Because M is on the floor.
Oh. Okay.
So if there's no further discussion on M, can we handle this?
Okay.
Okay. There's a motion, a second already on M. Please vote.
M as in Mike, right?
M as in Mike.
Okay. Let's see now how my vote is. And this is on the layover,
approval,
right?
Yes. No, this is approval.
Oh, it's approval. Okay, thank you. I'm trying to keep track of this.
Motion passes.
Okay. M is passed. Now, N, approval to appoint David Levy to the Douglas County Board of Commissioners. Now we're on N.
Motion to approve. Excuse me. Second.
Okay, there's a motion to approve by Boyle, second by Morgan.
And I will do a substitute motion to lay over a week.
I'll take that. I'll count that as an amendment. There's a motion to lay over a week by Kraft. Is there a second? There's a second by Kavanaugh. Any discussion on the motion to lay over a week? We already heard it to some degree. Hopefully we can move on that. Okay, with that, do you want to, Commissioner Kavanaugh, this is from the last comment, so I'm clearing this. I see no comments, so the vote is on the decision to lay over 1 week. Please vote.
Mr. Cavill. I turned off his machine. Motion passes.
Okay, item N will be laid over a week. With that, we go to citizens' comments. Item four, citizens' comments. Are there any citizens that want to comment on an agenda item not listed on the Douglas County Board of Commissioners agenda? Again, are there any citizens that want to comment on an agenda item not listed on the Douglas County Board of Commissioners agenda? Seeing none. Okay, Commissioner Morgan.
I think we should have a moment of silence in respect to what happened in Orlando to those individuals and also to their families. I think we should take a moment of silence.
Thank you, and we'll respect that now. Thank you. With that,
thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Morgan.
Mr. Chair, can I also add
Commissioner
to that,
Boyle,
that there will be a memorial service on Wednesday the 15th at 7 o'clock at the Metropolitan Community Church, which is located at 819 South 22nd Street.
Okay. Any other comments? Thank you. Item 6. Public hearing, item A, Douglas County's 1 to 6 year highway improvement plan for fiscal year 2017 to fiscal year 2022.
Good morning, commissioners. Tom Doyle, Douglas County engineer.
Good morning, Tom.
I want to make 2 points and then let Dan take over, Dan Kudelek. Number one, there is a specific process in place for adoption of a 1 and 6 year highway improvement plan. So I just wanted you to be aware of that particular point. Number two, Dan Kudelek, for how many years now, Dan, do you have?
Over 40.
He's got over 40 years of experience, and that's not just 40 years of the same experience. It's 40 progressively more professionally adept, and he does a great job on the 1 and 6 year plan. So it's with pleasure that I step aside to let him go ahead and make his annual presentation. If you have any questions about the process, I'm sure he could answer that too, because we do overkill. We actually go through the planning department before it gets to the board, and that is not a requirement, but it's a practice that we've followed for quite a long time. Dan?
Good morning, Commissioners. Dan Kudelek.
Good morning, Dan.
We're here for your consideration and hopefully approval on our 1 and 6 year plan. It's a 6 year total, obviously, and 1 year somewhat certain. It's a plan. It's not a fiscally constrained transportation improvement program. As Tom mentioned, we did meet last Wednesday night with the County Planning Commission, and they recommended their approval. We appreciated that with no comments. I'd briefly like to go over our 1 year plan and be more than happy to answer any questions. What we are currently attempting to do is catch up on our older bridges that are out in western Douglas County. We have currently 9 bridges that have been designed and are in the process of buying right away, and we'll be building those in the next two or three construction seasons as money becomes available. We currently have nine other structures that we've requested RFPs, proposals from consultants, and the A&E committee will be meeting here sometime in the near future, selecting some additional consultants to design those nine structures. And we would like to get those bridges that are currently structurally deficient or functionally obsolete on the ratings ready to be constructed as funds come available. There are funds actually that have been approved by the legislature, different statutes that will enhance our budget. I'm sure you can recall the controversy with the governor's office and the legislature on the gasoline tax increase of 6 cents. It's going to be programmed in over 6 years. But as a result of that, the counties, city, and the state of Nebraska will have an additional significant amount of money to spend on projects. The counties will be ultimately about $24 million that will be spread by a, we assume, the same formula that is being used now on how they distribute the trust fund monies. So that's an additional $2.4 million on the current numbers annually that we can expect in 6 years. So we want to get these projects shovel ready, so to speak, so we have projects to spend the money on. Number of other bills that have been passed, the federal buyback program for federal aid is now been approved by all the counties, and we actually received 90 cents on the dollar. The new state highway director just improved the percentage from 80 cents to 90 cents. He listened to the counties complain about the 20% administration fee that the state was charging, and so they did listen and adjusted it up to 90%. That's a significant amount of money for us. I'd say it's somewhere $650,000-$700,000 a year that is available, and a portion of that would be built and spent on our bridges too. The projects I'll mention to you briefly are some of our bigger, more maybe public notice projects. Our Q Street project is underway between 180th and 192nd. That's an arterial street improvement program, developer fee funded. I think it's a $12 million project or thereabouts. And we have one more construction season. If you've had the opportunity to drive down Q Street, you'll see a few barricades between that mile. But we have a very excellent contractor doing the job for us, and we expect him to have that finished this fall. So look forward to that. The project that I bring up every year is in a process of the environmental study. Our 180th Street project is our largest project we've ever undertaken, and it's the 10th year of the environmental study. We are anticipating submitting to the Federal Highway Administration the environmental document. It's been through the process for a number of years, and we've had pretty good effort recently from the Department of Roads and the Federal Highway to move that project along. We're on schedule to construct the project in 2019, start construction in 2019 and 2020. It's a two-year project on the first phase, which is basically the bridge over the main line of Union Pacific Railroad and the old Lincoln Highway. A lot of folks are rooting for us in the planning end of it and the development end of it, so we're trying to keep to that schedule on that project. I'll give you more reports on that as we get closer to construction. Out near our office, 156th Street, we're in a interlocal with the City of Omaha to improve 156th Street between Maple and Dodge Street, basically. It's a federal aid project. City is the lead agent. My understanding is they are in the right-of-way phase and intend to have the right-of-way purchase by the end of next year, 2017, So I hope to have a letting in the fall of 2017, construction in 18 and 19. It's a two-year project. We have recently, the economy has turned around, and there's a number of developments starting to show up. And we are historically participate in the improvements of the adjoining county roads adjacent to these new developments. And so we're going to start seeing some of that taking place this construction season, actually. I mentioned three of them. There's one out near Indian Creek in Elkhorn, north of Maple Street, 192nd. It doesn't exist today. There's no road there today, and we're going to build a new road that will ultimately connect Maple Street to Fort Street between east side of Indian Creek, and the new development is called Indian Point. So that job should start this fall. Ida Street, west of 144th, Waterford Edition, there's some commercial property that's going to be developed, and an interesting point is that they've set aside tens of thousands of cubic yards of earth that we need for a large fill section. It's kind of like a State Street jump there, if you're familiar with 144th and Ida, because of the grade change as you're heading westbound across 144th. It's currently a four-way stop sign, and it will be signalized, so we can't allow traffic to be going through that intersection at high speeds without a large embankment to build the profile to standard. So, but anyway, they set this dirt aside, and it will be a cost savings for us because the dirt will be convenient to haul into that location. So that's of interest, and we're taking bids on that, I believe, tomorrow, actually. We're opening a bid, so. Fort Street west of 204th, north of Elkhorn, a new school, elementary school, is going in on a gravel road. That's still gravel, very low volume road today, but it's going to be changing here in the next number of years. We've entered into an agreement with the developer and SID, and we'll be sharing the cost of paving, I think, about a quarter of a mile west of the highway on Fort Street. It'll go from a gravel road to a three-lane concrete street to handle the anticipated traffic. F Street, west of 204th, is another hot area. It's interesting how these things happen. 204th is Highway 31. It's all farm fields today, all the way out to 222nd Street on F. We've been in discussion with three different developers on interest in building residential houses out there. So what that means to us is F Street needs to be improved, and we'll be sharing in the cost over the next few years with those developers, and so you're going to see a lot of rooftops, I guess, west of 204th. The other thing we do include always in our 1 in 6, and I like to mention this because these are not as glitzy of projects, but they're so important, is the asphalt overlays and the micro-surfacing and chip sealing, we call them. I believe we have 19 miles of asphalt overlays this year. It's a very large project. And also, I think it's 37 miles of some sort of micro-surfacing or chip sealing, which extends the life of existing roads, basically, is what it does. And you need to do these types of projects on a systematic method. If you wait too long, it's too late, so to speak. So you have to do these types of projects when the roads are still, maybe in the public's eyes, look pretty good, but there are things going on road surfacing that need to be sealed and protected and keep the moisture out of the subgrade. So we're very aggressive this year in regard to that, and we always have been, actually, and I think it's paid dividends. You don't see the problems on our county roads as you might see in some other jurisdictions because of that. So the total work of this one-year plan, I think, is $41 million. of which about 11 million would be county. So the vast majority of the funds are shared by other revenue sources. It could be federal money, it could be developers' money, it could be these different new laws that have been in place. So we try to leverage our local money with the other monies to maximize the improvements we can ascertain on the county system. So that's about it in a nutshell, and I'd appreciate any questions you might have, and certainly would appreciate a favorable vote on our 1 in 6 year plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Just so people know, Commissioner Rogers had to leave. You're down to your third string chair now, and you'll understand the price you pay for that. Commissioner Boyle.
Well, thank you for recognizing me. I know it was hard. Excuse me. No, I first of all, you do a terrific job of making these presentations, and I will be voting for it. I have a question, though, about SID. There was a project C, and I just picked it out when looking through here, C28 and parentheses 531. Douglas County contributes 55%, City of Omaha 10, and the SID 34. Mm-hmm. When the project is done, who pays for the maintenance? I mean, if a chuck hole, pothole develops, do we pay for that?
We will, insofar as the portion in the county's jurisdiction. The city has a small portion, and so they would be responsible for that.
Well, if it's still in the county, wouldn't we have to maintain it?
Well, it's both city. The reason it's in the city, Commissioner, it's part of Standing Bear Lake.
Okay.
And the city annexed Standing Bear Lake as a city park a number of years ago. So it's that portion of this project that's in the city, actually.
Okay. And so how about plowing snow? Who does that? The county, the city?
I believe we plow the snow on Ida Street west of 144th.
Okay,
and it's a small, relatively small portion is in the city.
Okay. And then I also noticed one that I'm not real fond of. That's the lake that the NRD is building, 15A. But so I guess I'll be voting for that. But and I'm curious, too. I've been reading about some highway building that is doing some things like they have in southwest Iowa, where as you're traveling, there will be a passing zone where I don't know if we need those or have those. The three lanes that there is an area, slower traffic move right, and then mm-hmm. it's safe to pass. Is that what you're talking about with this three-lane highway, or is it just three lanes with a turn
well,
in the
it's
middle?
The project that affects the county, it requires a centered turn lane, so we're building a three-lane wide. What I think you're hearing about, and I've read some things on the website of the Department of Roads, the governor, it's called the Transportation Innovation Act, TIA. And what they have in place is they just reviewed over a number of years the standards that are required for public streets on state highway and city and county roads. And they've reduced, my understanding is they've reduced some of the stringent requirements. And so what the state is going to be looking at is adding passing lanes on their highways for trucks to move over in the slow lane, and cars can go by trucks as they're going across Nebraska without necessarily improving the entire road system.
Sure.
Just the areas where traffic gets slowed up by trucks pulling up grades, basically.
Okay, thank you.
That is being done because of the tremendous cost of construction. Yeah. And apparently it's had some success in other parts of the country, and state of Nebraska has adopted those standards, and they're going to be implementing them, is my understanding.
Okay. Will we see any of those in Douglas County, do you think? Possibly? Most of ours are four lanes, aren't they?
Yeah, so I don't think this affects Douglas County as much as the western counties.
The last thing I wanted to ask you is I've heard that the city is planning on annexing six SIDs. Do you get any warning of that? Or I know the county was responsible for fixing the awful tunnel, and as soon as that was done, the city went in and scooped it up. Are you warned of those, or does it make any difference to you?
We are. We have some contact with Public Works.
Sure.
Primarily is who we deal with, and they let us know before it's made public, usually, but not too much in the lead time. You know, that's kept close to the vest.
Well, I understand, because that's, you know, what they want, of course, is for the county to do the work and then annex later. Okay, I understand that. And well, I want to tell you, Dan, you repeatedly do a terrific job, and so does Mr. Doyle. Really a well-run office, and, you know, you just do a great job. I appreciate your service very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you, Commissioner Boyle. Commissioner Kraft.
I'm going to let Tom Doyle speak.
I would respond to one question that Commissioner Boyle. You guys, I want to be like you when I grow up. You've all done so much that I can't keep it straight.
Yeah, but PJ beat me for mayor.
In western Nebraska, in the Sand Hills area, this philosophy or practice of passing lanes is, you'll see that in. And the only one I remember and this was when I was with the Department of Roads, the gravel trucks coming out of the bottomlands out west of the rivers were holding up traffic, and we built some passing lanes back in the 70s. In Douglas County, those probably were converted to full concrete lanes, but that'd be the only area that I recall. So. Again, Jan does a great job, and I wanted to publicly acknowledge it and keep him from retiring in the near future.
Absolutely.
Hang around, Dan. Make it 45 at least.
Yeah. We'll make it the rule of 110.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks, Tom.
Okay. If I have some questions. Dan can talk, or you can. It doesn't. On the Transportation Initiation Act, or Initiative Act, which you brought up. I had a question about that earlier. I believe that's state regulations, correct?
It is. It's okay. To benefit the state, but the cities and counties will, it's $450 million will be split up. Yes.
Okay.
And we'll get some of that.
And part of my understanding is that if you have a wood trestle bridge or a rarely used bridge, you can repair it to the standards it was originally built for. You don't have to totally tear it out. So if you have a wood piling, you can replace a wood piling.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
That is correct.
Do we have many bridges like that in Douglas County?
Well, these 9 bridges I mentioned that we're going to be picking some consultants for, these structures are, you know, 75 years to 100 years old. And so, yes, we do have structures like that, and the decision would be made whether that's appropriate to do, or do you just do total replacement.
So we could see a significant savings there.
It's possible, yes, okay. Commissioner.
What is the cost per mile to build a 3-lane, replace the gravel road and a 3-lane highway or street or whatever you wish to call it, just for informational purposes?
I would say it's probably, for the whole mile, it would be about $3 to $4 million.
Okay. And a 4-lane, as I recall, was about, with curbs, was about $8 million a mile.
8 or 9, yes.
Okay. For 1 mile, yes. Isn't that?
Yeah.
Now, you were talking about micro-surfacing. Can you explain that just?
Well, it's a process where the contractor, places a product, that's pre-mixed onto the road. It's not a hot mix asphalt. It's something less than that in thickness, but it's a engineered, chemically balanced product that has high wearing ability and skid resistance.
Okay, so it's not the spray-on?
No, the spray-on is what we call chip sealing.
Okay, very good. Thank you. I have no further questions.
Thank you, Commissioner Kraft. Commissioner Cavanaugh.
Dan, just one quick question on this 180th Street project that you mentioned.
Yes, sir.
And that's been, kind of pending for a little bit. What's the completion date estimated for that project?
Start date's 2019, completion 2020 for phase one. That basically builds the bridge over the railroad and down to Blondo Street between the old Lincoln Highway and Blondo. The second phase will go from that point up to Maple Street, and that would be done in 22. So it's confusing. So it's two phases, 2 years each, started in 2019.
Okay, so during this, you know, six-year planning period, that entire project should be complete. Is that right?
Yes, that is our hope.
Good. I'd just like to take a minute to recognize Mr. Doyle's long contribution and excellent public service to the people of Nebraska and Douglas County in many different responsible capacities. I've known Tom since I was in short pants, and he is an inspiration to me and all other public servants. His method of quiet, effective, honest, and forthright public service should be an example to us all, and we're lucky to have him here with us today, and his department is a credit to the entire county. So I'd just like to say, Tom, thank you for all your many years of service, excellent service, and you've done a superb job, and hopefully will long into the future, and you and your staff are really a credit to Douglas County. Thank you very much.
Well, they deserve the most credit, because they're the ones who actually do the work on a daily basis. But I do appreciate your comments, Commissioner. I don't know what to say, but I'm going to get the recording of that sometime when we disagree on some issues and run it for you. But thank you very much. Of course, you know, it's just been, I think the first position I took in public government was in 1967 on the day of the Nebraska centennial, March 1st, 1967, at the Department of Labor when I became Commissioner of Labor for Governor Thiemann, and then in 71 for Governor Exon, the Highway Department, and then when our county engineer left to take one of my old jobs, I moved here in 83, and like I say, when I grow up, I'll let you guys know how it finally comes out. But I appreciate over the years the support that this board has given to our department, because without that kind of support, we couldn't have done half the things that we really do. And we appreciate, we hope to live up, we expect to live up to that in the future. So remember, I'll need that recording.
Well, thank you, Mr. Doyle, and I've got to say, you were in at the beginning for the centennial celebration of 100 years of Nebraska in 1967. And the next year we'll be celebrating the sesquicentennial of 150 years, and during that 50-year addition to Nebraska's history, you've made an enormous contribution. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. I remind you that Nebraska, under Governor Exon and my tenure, we closed the Golden Link in western Nebraska in 1974, became the first state in the country to complete our interstate mileage, and we did do that. Of course, the other side of that is the reason that we were first was we got the least amount of mileage. Because we don't have a north-south interstate, and we're probably the only state that doesn't. But again, it's been a fun ride. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
A lot of history there.
Yeah, really.
Commissioner Boyle.
Well, I only wanted to add, that was a wonderful thing, Jim, and I agree with you totally, is that from my perspective, your claim to fame is that you work with my dad, who was the chief mixed man making ice cream at Seal Test Ice Cream.
Wow.
When you were a young man, and my dad, when I was running for mayor, I know you were there, and my dad was there, and you were a good friend of his, and he was quite a bit older than you, obviously, but right. I remember that very well.
Right, it's your dad, and your uncle was also
yep.
an employee there, and I would pull butter during the morning hours, and then we couldn't shower, and I went to my baseball games CYO smelling like butter. That's another claim to fame.
Yeah, my dad's brother worked at Harding downtown making butter, and my dad worked next door in a fire, but he made ice cream, so they're quite the team. Right. Rode the streetcar out, the Benson. Anyway, it was great times. I have such great memories of you, and your wonderful wife, too. Anne was a terrific woman.
Thank you, Michael.
Thank you, Commissioner Boyle. This is a public hearing. Is there anybody from the public that would like to share any comments concerning the 1 and 6 year plans for the county? If not, we will close the public hearing.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any comments or questions?
Including 15A.
Then I would ask for the vote.
Yes.
Who made the motion?
I think we could. It was motion by Boyle, second by Kraft, is what I had. Okay.
And new way of doing things.
Motion passes.
Okay. This brings us then to the budget report. Commissioners Morgan or Boyle, do you have anything?
We'll have a meeting after this, and I think there's a resolution we may have to take care of, Joe.
Do you know what time you might be doing that, do you think? We'll give a notice at the end of the meeting what time we'll be.
Fine.
There'll be a short break.
All right.
Okay, and then we also have a resolution to, for our bond refinancing to authorize the issuance of some refunding bonds. And it's correct on the resolution itself. The amount is $24 million in the agenda. It says $25 million, but the correct amount is $24 million. That's in the actual resolution, and we're going to look to be refunding the county's outstanding general obligation refunding bonds, both series 2011 and series 2011B, and the timing here is good in terms of what interest rates are doing. I just looked this morning and the 10-year treasury rate was under 1.6, so and Bruce Leffler's here from Emeritus and Parker Schenken from Baird Home, and I think we're pretty close on ready to go with this. So I think this does have the advantage with these fall in interest rates that we should be able to realize considerable interest savings on these outstanding issues by refinancing them, and that interest savings is direct savings to the county and the general fund. So I think our timing on this is very, very good right now.
I'd make a motion to approve. Is that the recommendation?
Motion by Morgan, seconded by Kraft. To approve item A2, the resolution authorizing the issuance of general obligation refunding bonds, not to exceed $25
million. Sure.
Go ahead.
Parker Schenken, Baird Holm, and I'm bond counsel on this. There are technically three resolutions in the packet that you have. There are two separate resolutions to authorize the calling of the two series of bonds that are being refunded. So a call resolution for 2011, call resolution for 2011B, and then the authorizing resolution authorizing the issuance of the refunding bonds. So I think as a matter of order, you're working on three separate items.
Okay, thank you. Are the maker and seconder of the motion comfortable with
yes.
this, that the motion will cover all three of these items?
Yes.
Can't? Do we need them?
Well, I was just going to ask for maybe.
Should they be separate? Would it be cleaner?
Well, I believe so, but I'm not sure if they all three of them were on.
Are they on the agenda?
Ooh.
Checking the backup right now.
Item itself, the way it's written, there should be three of them.
Resolution is plural.
Oh, I see.
Okay. Yeah. Look at the exact wording to be used for the agenda where it says authorize the calling and redemption of county's outstanding general obligation refunding bond series 2011 and the county's outstanding general refunding bond series 2011B, and the issuance and sale of Douglas County general obligation refunding bond series 2016. So like I said, the actual agenda item and the resolutions themselves are there written for three resolutions.
Very good. Thank you. And the maker and seconder of the motion are comfortable that this is how we're proceeding?
Yes.
Thank you. Further, excuse me, Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Thank you. Joe, just a couple of questions on the three individual issues, I guess, right?
Three resolutions, yeah.
Yeah. Three separate bonds, correct?
Well, it would be my understanding, we'd be calling two series of bonds, the 2011 and 2000B, and then maybe Parker, you can come up and talk about why we'll probably have to issue, when we refinance, it'll be two different issues.
Again, Parker Shankin, Baird Home, 1500 Woodman Tower. Typically, when you do a multi-purpose issue where you're issuing one series of bonds to refund multiple bonds, you do it all at once. So you'd have the 2016 bonds for the purpose of refunding 11 and 11B. In this case, there's a technical difference between the credit behind the 11 and the 11B, not one that's material, I don't think, to the rating agencies or others, but one is subject to the county's constitutional 50-cent levy limit. The other, as a voted bond, is not. And so inside that third resolution, the big one that authorizes the issues, it authorizes the issuance of the refunding bonds in two separate series so that you can kind of, one bond issue will track the credit backing of the 2011 bond issue, which is subject to the 50-cent limit. One bond issue will track the credit backing of the 2011B, which is authorized to exceed the 50-cent limit. It's a minor distinction, but it does require that we do two separate refunding issues going forward. I hope that makes some sense.
Hold up for one second. So if I understand this, there are two 2011 bond issues and one 2003 bond issue?
No.
Okay.
No, no. The refunded bonds, the bonds you're refinancing, are two series that were issued in 2011. One is the 2011 bonds, which were, they're outstanding in about $6,400,000, and they were refinancing health center improvements. Those are the ones that are subject to the 50-cent levy limit. The second series is the 2011B, which is outstanding now in about $16,260,000. Those were voted correctional center bonds that by the vote were authorized to exceed the limit. If they both had the exact same credit quality, we'd do a single refunding bond issue and lump them together. But because of that slight distinction, we've got to issue the refunding bonds separately.
Okay, so it's the $6,400,000 from the 2011 issue, and then the 2011B in the amount of $16,260,000.
Yes, sir. Yep.
Okay, that's it.
That's it.
Yep. Okay. Then, relative to the interest rates that are outlined in these resolutions, those are the interest rates that we anticipate capturing going forward by the refinancing?
So the way the resolution is set up, it allows your underwriter to go to the market and capture what they believe is the best rates possible. The resolution you're approving has a maximum interest rate that's going to be allowed, and I believe that's stated to be 3% in Section 2 of that resolution. You probably got to hunt for it, but I can find it for you. It's going to be no more than that. You're approving the issuance of the bonds up to that amount. At the time, the underwriter goes to the market and gets a proposed scale for each of the refunding bond issues. They'll come back, and the board chair or clerk comptroller or director of finance and budget will then approve those final terms on behalf of the board. But within those parameters, there's a maximum maturity, there's a maximum interest rate. It's locked down within some parameters that you're approving.
Okay. So help me out here, because I notice in the two separate packages, for instance, in the first issuance on the $6,400,000, the interest rate per annum, this would be the maximum, for 2016 is 2%. And on the 2011B issue for $16,260,000, the interest per annum for 2016 is 1.5%. That's the maximum that we would entertain.
So I believe you may be looking at, I'm not sure, I don't have, you may be looking at a presented scale that was sort of indicative numbers that Bruce can comment on.
If I may.
Right, yeah, sure, Bruce.
For the record, Bruce Lafleur, Meredith Investment Corp.
The numbers that you're referring to are in, those are the interest rates that are on the bonds that are outstanding. So the bonds that are subject to redemption for outstanding, I think on the resolutions that you're looking at show in 2016 and 2011 is 2%.
Okay.
Or and through 3.75%. That's the rates that are on the outstanding bonds.
Okay.
As it's referenced in the call resolutions. We do, our anticipation certainly is, yeah, and 1.5% on the 2011 Bs. Those are the bonds, that's the interest rate on the bonds that are outstanding.
Okay.
Okay. So our anticipation is that we're going to be in an interest rate environment that's, you know, closer to 2% on the refunding bonds, but that doesn't reflect in any of these numbers because we haven't been to the market with the bonds yet. As Joe mentioned, we anticipate that we're going to have rating confirmation of the county's AAA rating on Moody's and S&P by the end of this week, and we'll be in the market with these bonds Tuesday or Wednesday of next week, and be able to reduce that overall interest expense down to 2% or less.
Okay.
But, yeah.
So the
rates you're looking at are what's outstanding on these bonds right now.
I appreciate that.
Okay.
So the rate that we were talking about in terms of the maximum that we would entertain,
right.
Are those reflected in these documents anywhere?
It just, there's a portion of the resolution that says that the interest rate on the refunding bonds, the 2016 issue, won't exceed 3%. And I don't think we'll get to that number, because if I show Joe refunding numbers at 3%, he's probably going to kick me to the curb and say no thank you. But
right.
we have to put a threshold in there.
Right.
And so that's where the threshold's been set.
And for clarity, you might be saying that you'll find that, by the way, on page page 8 of the big resolution.
Uh-huh.
In the back there are a series of parameters. The second one, clause B, has the maximum. It says true interest cost. And just for clarity for everybody, when you look at the refunded bonds, Commissioner Cavanaugh raises a good point, they'll just see a series of serial bond interest rates that run from the short end at a low, you know, 2 or 1.5, the ones you saw. Well, that's less than 3. Why would you refund that? Well, you refund it because taken as a whole, when you look beginning to end, the aggregate interest rate or true interest cost ends up lower with a refunding bond issue. The true interest cost is the aggregate interest rate across the life of the refunding bond issue. So
right.
Bottom line, it's
and I appreciate that's the
yeah.
purpose of the whole exercise,
yeah.
is to capture a lower
interest
rate going
exactly.
forward.
Absolutely. Right.
And you're assuring us that that in fact will happen.
Will happen. If again, the argument is if interest rates this week for whatever purpose run away,
right.
and increase, then we don't bring the issue to marketplace. We won't be doing it, exactly.
And it's my understanding that the most recent indications from the Fed is that they are not going to pursue an interest rate increase in the short term at their next meeting this month?
Later this week. Actually,
summer?
Later this week, yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. That's certainly the indications that we're getting.
So the indication seems to be in the marketplace that the interest rates for these types of investments will stay at its current level for at least the short-term future.
In an election year, you always run into those type of situations. Yeah, they're certainly right. I would agree with you.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Okay, our pleasure.
Thank you, Commissioner Cavanaugh. Commissioner Morgan.
Just for Commissioner Cavanaugh's benefit, and I think you two would agree with me, when they raised the interest rate, what was it, last August,
mm-hmm.
the Fed raised the interest rate, you could borrow 10-year money, 7-year money, 5-year money 2 months ago less than what you could borrow for last August after they raised it,
right.
which is pretty amazing.
It is.
So it doesn't mean that the rates are going to go up, even if the Fed did raise it because of what is
right.
seen out there. So you, what's going to happen is the same as refinancing your home. We're going to save money on our payments. I've gone over it with Joe.
Right.
This is great. And we thank you for that.
Wonderful opportunity.
Yes.
Thanks.
Our pleasure. Thank you again.
Thank you, Commissioner Morgan. Other questions or comments? Then I guess we're ready to vote.
Commissioner Morgan and Commissioner Kat, or just Commissioner Morgan now.
Did you get me?
I did. Motion passes.
Thank you.
This brings us to item three under the Finance Committee, the discussion of .com's new ShoreTel phone system and cost for Commissioner Boyle. Commissioner?
Yes. We just had our new telephones and voice over internet equipment installed. And so I asked, and I appreciate Diane and Derek, the head of .com and our liaison, to come down and tell us what it's all about, why we did it, what are the advantages, what's the cost. If you do that, I would really appreciate it.
Sure.
Shed some light on what's going on and speak into the microphone for my hearing.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good morning, Commissioners. Diane Wallace, Douglas County's IT coordinator. So thanks for the opportunity to give an update on our Enterprise ShoreTel VoIP phone system initiative. This was launched because of needs. Our own, our old legacy phone system had very limited functions, is aging. And because of that, some of our departments had already gone off and purchased their own phone systems in order to get better functionality, call routing, messaging, things like that. But even those systems are aging, and it becomes more difficult for support and to get parts. So together, what we did back in May of 2013, the project was launched with funding from the Projects for Success. And the initial funding was $324,000. Out of that, we were able to create a shared infrastructure used by both the city and the county for the VoIP phone system. The initial phones were deployed at .com and at city planning. And in 2014, some of our initial county phones were implemented. Since that point, going forward, ongoing funding is coming from the individual department.
From where?
From the individual department budgets. So we work with the departments to understand their needs, their requirements. They take a look at this system, they understand the benefits, and they decide if that's something they need and if it's something they can afford. Some departments look at it and put their project on hold. Some departments have looked at it and decided, yes, I want it, I can pay for it, and so they've moved forward. So in 2014, 15, and 16, we've deployed the phone system at multiple county departments. We're basically at total for city, county, building commission, and .com, around 800 phones in the new system. And of those, about 300 are county phones. Now, the benefits around this, think of it like cost shifting, right? We paid for phones before. Some phones might be basic phones. Some phones might have had additional features like ISDN, voicemail. So there's a wide range of the types of phones that were in place and the functionality needed on those phones. So we're cost shifting. And if we take a look at what we've spent with CenturyLink for the Centrix system, if we look at the dollars we spent in 2013 in total and we look at the dollars spent in 2015 in total, we've already experienced a 10% decrease in the amount of dollars we're spending with CenturyLink. Now, along with that cost shift, we also get the benefits of more features and functionality. And so as we do these projects, we work with each department and their specific users, and we understand their requirements. Some folks have very basic phone needs. Some offices get a lot of incoming calls. Some phones have receptionists, front people. They need more features and functionality. So we get phone features on the phone itself. We get features for voicemail, displaying voicemail in the email so you can see if you missed a call. One of our offices realized they have the ability to do disaster site recovery. So if for some reason that office wasn't available, these phones can just be grabbed, picked up, and move it, or we can, in our system, reroute the calls to ring other VoIP phones. So it gives them some good options to just pick up and move and be operational if something were to happen, a power outage or something to their office. There's also functionality called Follow Me. So if you're away from your desk and your desk phone rings, the system can automatically forward that to a mobile device, to your cell phone, so people can find you wherever you're at. You could not even have a physical phone. You could just be using a computer, maybe with a headphone, computer mic and speakers, or the software could not ring a phone at all and could forward that call directly to your cell phone. So there's a lot of good features and functionalities that can be configured based on the user and the department requirements. And it basically, because it's software driven, it's less
phone dependent than what we were in the past. It's really good for those, again, receptionists that have a lot of volume of calls, or if a department wants some messaging where you call in, you first hear some informational information about office and services and hours. That functionality is all available. And basically, all these benefits increase as we have more and more users and departments on the system, because now we're kind of getting back to everybody on one system. There's a directory. You can just look up a number, point, click, call somebody from your computer. The more people are in the on the voice system are in that directory, too. So as we do these projects with the departments, another big benefit is that we kind of do a little department audit. We work on their requirements, but we also say, well, what phone lines do you have today, and do you need all those phone lines? In general, what we're finding is about 15% of the department phone lines are turned off because they're not needed, or we do this call routing. They don't need to get calls directly from the outside. So by turning down those phone lines, that gives us cost savings with CenturyLink. We're turning off phone lines. It also frees up some phone numbers that can be reused for new users, new phones. So a lot of good benefits, a lot of good options, enterprise shared system, meeting needs that were unmet before. So.
Thank you, Dan. The floor is still yours.
One of the problems that I've experienced using the present system, and maybe this is alleviated with this new system, is that I was talking to someone who needed to be forwarded to another department, and I believe it was corrections, so it has a different prefix than ours, and I wasn't able to do it. Will this system allow us to do that?
There is the ability to transfer phone calls basically to any number inside to a different prefix, like corrections, or to an outside person.
You basically
can transfer the phone call anywhere inside or outside of our offices. Okay. Now, with any new system, there's a little bit of a learning curve. So part of this implementation is folks are given some training too. It takes a few days to get comfortable, but there's very good call transferring functionality in the phones and in the system.
Okay, and you mentioned a $324,000 grant. Where was that from?
This was from Projects for Success. So years back, we did bonds with the city, again, to improve the tech center, new computer, new hardware. So there was many different projects we did out of that bond funding. And this was determined as one of the important things to do. And so the dollars were approved out of that bigger bond offering to do this system.
Okay, I'm still confused. A bond?
This was called Projects for Success.
Was that voted on?
It was launched before I started, shortly before, but it was basically the dollars used to redo the tech center, the computer center in the sea level of this building. So a large number of dollars were made available, city and county together, buying new computer equipment, working with the building commission, redoing the tech center. So those things were all getting done around 2012.
Joe, do you remember that? Is that a bond issue?
What it was is that was the approach about 5 or 6 years ago to raise capital spending for .com, and how that financing was done was a joint city-county project, but the city issued the bonds, and they were 5-year bonds, and over time we've been making the bond payments. We're actually scheduled, I think, to make the last payment in a few months. But it's not really a grant per se. It was really just a mechanism to do the capital funding required for these certain projects.
So something like this could be used for the election commissioner's office and maybe the assessor register of deeds?
Well, they were, these bonds were actually issued by the city of Omaha, who has more flexibility in how they can offer bonds than we did. So they were city bonds that we participated in the bond repayment of.
Did it take a vote of the people, or how did they do
no,
that?
No, no. Because it was the city of Omaha, it didn't require a vote of the people.
That's pretty bizarre. Okay. You mentioned department budgets are paying for these. Do you know what those costs are?
What I've told people is, as we've looked at this on an ongoing basis, one of the a major cost was rewiring this building, and Claire probably remembers this, that we pushed, and eventually the building commission came to agree that as a landlord they should cable the building to accept the voice over IP. So that part was done by the building commission, which really left the remaining cost being the actual hardware for the phones themselves, you know, actually buying the phones. And the position that I've gone out and told all the departments is that, you know, we can see this coming for years. You guys should, you know, be squirreling away some money so that you could go out and buy these phones, you know, encumber it if necessary, so that in the point where you're ready to go, you'll have these funds available to you to go out and purchase the actual phones. And I would say most departments have been working that way, and that has been our approach. So instead of giving a specific incremental amount of to buy this phone hardware, we've really been having the departments fit it into their existing budgets to fund it.
Okay, did the wiring, didn't that cost $7 million?
I can't. Do you remember, Claire, how much it was?
No, it wasn't.
I don't think
it was
much.
A small fraction of that. I don't remember the amount, but.
How much?
$5
million?
$500,000.
Okay, thank you. Yeah.
And that recabling then enables all the computers on the computer network to work better, too. And then these VoIP phones are on that same computer network.
And, Joe, can you get a hardware cost put together, too? Because this is kind of a sleeper in the budgets. I don't remember discussing this at all.
Yeah, I mean, because every, you know, before any department gets it, they go out and work with .com and they get a bid and are told, you know, you need this many phones, and the phones and the training will cost that much. And but we could pull that. I'm sure we have. There's a whole project team put together from .com who is working on the implementation of this, and we can certainly pull those numbers. I know they're available.
Okay, you mentioned, I don't know if I understood this correctly, but this replaces Centrex. Is that wrong or right?
Right, because now you're basically have the new phones on our computer network being run by this software that delivers the calls. So we have some amount of lines or trunks that need to come into the tech center so you can call people on the outside. But if you're calling people inside, you know, VoIP to VoIP, it all stays on our network.
Okay, and what does it really mean, replace Centrex? Is that hardware? Is that what it is? Or
that's
what?
Like the outside provider from CenturyLink, the phone system that CenturyLink is providing for us that we pay for.
So now it's all .com and it's your computer.
For the folks, yeah, for the folks that have been, those 800 phones that are deployed so far.
But eventually,
so we still have a mix.
Eventually, it'll be everybody.
The goal is, as they're able to fund these projects, to have more and more of the departments on the
system.
So
what would the savings be from that financially, do you think? I mean, I don't need that this minute, but I'd like to know. I really want to know the finances of all this, because I kind of view, I don't mean to be disrespectful, but sometimes people in government, you know, and not you, people like me, want to have the latest thing with the latest bells and whistles, and we seem to forget, you know, who's paying for it. That's my problem. Mm-hmm. And I don't know whether, you know, this is, maybe it sounds like it's a good investment, but I don't know. You talk about having more features. I don't know what there is besides answering the phone and transferring a call. I mean, that, to me, that's about it. Maybe voicemail, which I hate. And I certainly don't like what the health department does. They have about they have 20 questions they ask you at the beginning, and then they hang up. Mm-hmm. So, boy, I'll tell you, not too good a deal. But anyhow, that's what I don't want to see, and I just think we need to keep focusing on who it is that we're serving here. I'm curious about, you mentioned forwarding numbers to cell phone. That's what I've done for quite some time here, and I use my own telephone. I don't have a county cell phone, and I don't have a county telephone landline. And so when someone calls 7025, they want to talk to me, they do ask the name and number just in case it gets lost in the shuffle. And they transfer it to my phone, which when it rings, it says taxpayer, and I answer it if I'm available. I've had calls during this meeting that go to voicemail. But I just think we need to focus on that, and I intend to really pursue this big time. So looking forward to working with you so that we don't have any, we have, if in our office, we would have one landline. And Tony Dunn, who sits at the front desk, would answer that call. And if they're calling for Joe, they would send it to his cell phone. And if they're calling for Commissioner Duda, his cell phone, whichever one he designates. I don't know if he has, you don't have a county phone.
No, I do not.
Okay, so he gets to answer that at home or wherever he is, out on the tractor. So, but I mean, that is a big problem. We're spending $253,000 on cell phones. Yeah, $253,000 on cell phones. And the same people using the cell phones have landlines. And so, you know, and I think we're spending, and of course, I think CenturyLink may be in there with 911, but I think the figure I got was $500,000. So we're spending, you know, $750,000, $800,000 on telephones for less than 800 people. I mean, I just think, this is what I think we've lost, not your fault again, we have lost our focus, we've lost our way on what it is we're doing here. I just think there, and I am dedicated to taking all those phones that you just installed out, and we're gonna send, everybody's gonna get a cell, if you have a cell phone, a county cell phone, even if you don't, you know, you're gonna get transferred, your calls, that has to happen. We haven't got any money. We can't afford this stuff, so anyway.
Well, the good thing about this system, it is very configurable, so there's lots of different scenarios that it can help us to do. It gives us more options than what we had in the past on the old system. And what we do is we work with the departments, what are their requirements, and then configure the system to do what's needed. So if those requirements change, the system can change too.
You know, the old system worked just well. Because if you called my office and you do that, well, of course, now they're changed, but if you called the county board office and asked for me, it would come through here.
Mm-hmm.
And so the feature was already present. So that's, when I saw all the new phones, Joe was present, saw me mm-hmm. blow a gasket. And anyway, I just really think we, you know, it's our responsibility to focus on what it is, so what we can afford. And I won't keep you anymore. I do appreciate the work that you do.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate .com. They've bailed me out so many times on my computer and my passwords and everything else. So I don't have any axe to grind with you, and I want you to know that.
Mm-hmm.
But I do have a problem with public officials like us, and I'll speak for myself, me not being vigilant enough to stop this, because I just don't see the use. I don't think we need all these. I don't know what features we need other than transferring calls and answering the phone. That, to me, is about it.
But Commissioner, we're really just replacing a 1980s analog technology with a modern digital technology. We're not an early adapter on this. If you look at most organizations our size, they've had this sort of system for years now already. We're just really trying to bring our phone system into the 21st century.
I don't think we needed to. I think what we had was working fine. I think what we had was working fine.
We did have some examples of high operational
Derek?
Risk. So we're trying to address risk and get features and then do that cost shift.
Derek Cruz, Douglas, Omaha Technology Commission, CIO. I'd just like to make one comment with respect to affordability. Diane's right. This does help us with those departments that if something were to happen to their building, they are operational. If they move down the street, they could come down here, .com. So that's a huge advantage, right, from a risk perspective. Joe alluded to the fact that we're not early adopters. Most people are moving to this. And every time another business moves to voice over IP, that cost of our traditional phone system from the 80s goes up, right? So it goes up every year. We start to see those cost increases for those individual phone lines for that old system. Eventually, it will be unaffordable to use that old system because there won't be anybody on it anymore, right? So you'll see the cost of it increase. I understand what you're saying, but I just want to drive that. There is an economic reason that we're doing this over time. It's a cost shift right now, but eventually those CenturyLink phones, those traditional phones, the cost is going to continue to rise. So we've got to get in front of this. Otherwise, we'll be sitting here going, why didn't we deal with this when we could? Now your suggestion about everyone moving to cell phones, that's something we could pilot and look at. And as Diane alluded to, the system we have is perfect for that because we can route those calls any which way we need to. That follow me feature is really helpful for what you're describing, Commissioner.
So we didn't need the 531 prefix after all. We can use all these other garbled numbers and try to figure it out. Anyway, I do. It's interesting you bring up moving the phones because our emergency management department has only done one. The election commissioner's office is the only one who has actually gone through an emergency practice and moved their phones.
Right.
The rest of us are all, you know, we're all in a coma. We're not doing anything, which is ridiculous. So I expect that I'm going to ask the emergency management director to get everybody up on their toes, and we're going to have some. When I was mayor, I used to call disasters and just see how everybody acted. We ran down the basement, turned on that thing, and had a good time. But anyway.
And kudos to elections. They were very proactive in wanting to do that disaster. And kudos to .com, who was very supportive in facilitating and hosting and bringing them into C-level and proving we could bring them up and be operational.
Right. Yeah. Well, Brian Cruz deserves credit for that, and I appreciate your cooperation. And again, this is not, you know, the fifth degree, but I do have, I'm just cheap. I'm cheap. You should see what we have at our house. Dial. No, we're not.
Operator.
Yeah, operator. We have a party line. Okay, thanks a lot.
Thank you
very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Commissioner Boyle. We have something also from Commissioner Kraft.
Okay.
Yes. Hold on. Diane or Derek, whoever can answer this. You mentioned that we had 800 phones between the city and the county. 800 out of what is the potential pool?
4,000, roughly 4,000, okay. Yeah.
And
now, some of those 4,000 are on the old phone system, and some are on other phone systems that they bought to address this need individually, okay. Too.
And because I've studied VOIP, and there is a significant savings.
Mm-hmm.
And with that savings, the increase in functionality. Of the many cell phones we have, I don't know if you'll have this information now, but how many of those are actually not cell phones but computer data plans?
There are some. So depending on the numbers you were looking at, you do have to be careful to know the numbers of cell phones and the number of data plans for mobile devices. You're correct. Both of those would be seen as charges from Verizon.
And can we find out what the difference is?
Yeah, we get that on our monthly bill.
Since Commissioner Boyle focuses on the cell phones so many times.
Yeah, we
and,
do have
you know, rightly so. You know. Mm-hmm. But by the way, I do have in my bedroom a dial rotary phone. So that's all. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Kraft. Any further discussion?
I only want to ask, excuse me, Joe, if he would put together the costs of, you know, what is this costing to shift to it? What are we saving? What's the implications to 911? You know, all this sort of stuff. I'd like to see that information to get a grasp of all the costs, the savings, the whole deal. Thanks.
Thank you, Commissioner Boyle.
Thank you.
Okay, this will move us along on the agenda then. We'll go up to item D, the Community Services Committee, where Commissioner Kraft has asked for the floor for a point of personal privilege. Commissioner
yes.
Kraft.
We had a community service meeting this morning, committee meeting, and it was on environmental services. And I have to tell you, it was a very exciting meeting, as Commissioners Morgan and Duda can attest. One of the items we discussed was under the sink, which is where we recycle and get rid of items no longer useful in the house, such as paint. You have a quarter gallon of paint. We don't want you to put in the landfill. And I had totally forgotten that if you go out to under the sink, you can get paint that people wanted to dispose of totally free. So if you have a project where you're painting a schoolhouse, if you have a project where you're painting a shed, you don't need a lot of paint, especially if you don't care what color. An excellent opportunity for people to get involved in environmental services. So that's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you.
Does everyone know where the sink is?
Oh, 100 and...
Is it 111th 11th. And I?
111th and
under I. UnderTheSink.org?
Yeah, UnderTheSink.org.
Does that sound right? Okay.
It's actually 120th.
120th and I.
Thank you.
Okay. I was out there once. It's not open every day. It was closed on the day I went out there.
Commissioner Duda?
Commissioner Boyle.
That's why I wanted to ask Commissioner Kressley. Today I looked it up on my phone under Google, and it's got the address and everything. This is closed today. Well, I've driven out there, and excuse me, didn't check the phone, but they have the most bizarre hours.
Do they?
Well, and the other thing is, it would really be helpful, and I asked for it about 2 years ago, to put a sign out front that you can read from driving a car that says, you know, closed Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. We're open from 10 to 11. I mean, the hours are, I mean, I respect the people. I go out there, I take all this stuff out there, and atomic waste that we have at our house and so forth. But the deal is they're so hard to get to. I mean, not hard to get to, but they're not open. And I don't know when their hours are. It'd be so nice if they would just put a sign out front. I know they're on the web and all that stuff, but I'm driving a car and I can't do this. So anyway. Just a suggestion.
If I may, you said atomic waste. I think you meant biohazard.
No, I'm trying to help Fort Calhoun.
Those are good suggestions. I will remind the board this is city-driven, but we can certainly take to our partner at the city what I think is a very good suggestion.
Thanks.
Of how to enhance the services they provide. Thank you. Does that conclude what you wanted, Commissioner Kraft? Thank you. We will skip down to the Human Resources Committee with the weekly personnel report from Civil Service. Anything of note here that anybody would like to address? Okay, legislative issues. The legislature is not in session. Yay. So I'm not aware of any legislative issues. Commissioner Kavanaugh.
Well, there is an ongoing interim study relative to the crime lab question, and I think that what we can probably expect is sometime later this summer that they will reach some conclusion relative to what, if any, action the legislature should entertain next year regarding the state's crime lab needs. And I know that's ongoing because I've been contacted by senators on a regular basis relative to that issue. So just an FYI that the state is probably going to have something to say legislatively about the crime lab issue in January.
Thank you, Commissioner Kavanaugh. Anything else under legislation? We do have need for an executive session for purposes of discussing personnel and potential litigation.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
We are going to executive
second.
Motion and a second, Kraft and Boyle, to go into executive session for personnel and potential litigation. Could we please have the vote? Thank you all.
Motion passes. Sorry. No, you're fine. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Above the fruited plain.